freely receive, freely give. As you think through the question of the freedom and value, the most important one is, how will this business help people? This isn't simply about being generous, because as the business helps people, the business owner gets paid. Some people design an entire for-profit business around the social component, others shift to the focus on it as they go along, and still others integrate a social project within a for-profit business. Apartheid came to an end in South Africa in 1994, ending nearly half a century of white-only rule in Africa's most economically developed country. Nelson Mandela was elected the first black president the same year, and the country began a slow process of creating true equality for its rainbow nation of the people. In addition to the negative association of the apartheid, South Africa was known for many good things, one of which was its popular prize-winning wine. The wine region of the Western Cape is older than the Californias. South Africa provided the royal courts of Europe with wine for over 350 years, and South African vines were used to start the Australian wine industry in 1781. Yet, because of the apartheid, the $3 billion wine industry had less than 2% black ownership, despite the fact that blacks represented 80% of the country's population. Enter the Curry and Selena Cafu, a husband and wife team from the United States, who found a way to create a highly profitable business that supports black vineyard owners in South Africa. Selena, the CEO, explains it like this. "This venture merges my passion for entrepreneurship with social justice. The greatest benefit is that my personal and business goals are identical. Positively changing people's perception of the African continent and helping to reinstill a sense of family and connectivity into the lives of the people that our business touches." Wow. Well said, but it's so hard, right? In Tel Aviv, Israel, Daniel Nisiman founded a paintball distributor called Matix Ltd. "The business stood out to me because of his unique client base. We sell extreme sports equipment to the enthusiasts in Israel and neighboring countries, and also to the Israeli defense establishment for training purposes. Despite the sudden appearance of the number of the competitors that sprang up in the response to the growth of the paintball in Israel, business was good. Matix Ltd. was clearing six figures in income and had sewn up exclusively contracts with the key suppliers, thus sweating in the new competitors. Daniel went back and forth between the Israel and US, and his previous venture was non-profit that taught karate to children with developmental disabilities in Southern California. Paintball was fun, but Daniel wanted something that combines a non-profit model he started in California with a sports business he ran in Tel Aviv. He found the answer in a new venture called Green Color, a project that will reduce landfill waste inefficiency while also tapping an overlooked energy source. The goal is to work with municipal governments in both Israel and Palestine Authority in an effort to solve common problems and advance joint interest." Here is what Daniel has to say. "Much more than with Matrix, the paintball business, I wake in the morning feeling I'm making the world a better place, and I don't need to suffer for it. I don't need to volunteer my time to another NGO or donate money. I instead have focused my best of efforts to make the world a better place for my country and for my children. And I will also be compensated for it. Ha! Whether you follow Daniel's model of designing a business around the social cause and being paid for it, or find a way to incorporate a community project into your existing business, many entrepreneurs find this to be a critical, fulfilling part of their work. Huh. Okay. Jane and Omar follow the $100 startup model, focusing on the specific combination of their unique skills. They made an interesting product that other people also valued. They gave their customers what they wanted without hiding their real lives. Their website contains a blog and entries on their home life, complete with cat photos, but doesn't go into all the details of making prints that most customers would find irrelevant. They choose a marketable idea and were encouraged by their first day of sales. They kept costs low, bootstrapping out of their tiny apartment and not borrowing a single dollar. As the business grew rapidly, they regrouped, taking stock of what was working, make more maps, and what wasn't, stop going to the post office all the time. Most important, instead of thinking about it forever or filling up binder with projections, Jane and Omar took action. Ah, Mr. Iijima, it's time to do that, right? Key points. Plan as you go to the response to the changing needs of your customers, but launch your business as soon as possible with a bias toward action. Ha 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 ha, with a bias toward action. Nick's first print sale provided far more motivation than the $50 he received. Ah, as soon as possible, find a way to get your first sale. Okay, Takayuki. Follow the 7 steps to instant market testing, or the market before manufacturing method, to gauge the initial response. Use the one-page business plan to outline your business ideas quickly. To avoid overcomplicating things, explain your business with a 140-character mission statement. Wow!